Leading us in prayer today is the Reverend Peggy Stimson from the First United Methodist Church, and she will be followed by Nicholas Lust of Rapid City, who will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Please stand.
And will you pray with me? Creator of all God, we thank you for the gift that is today. We ask that your Spirit would fill each and every one of our hearts and minds to discern your will above all else, that we would serve you faithfully. For God, you have entrusted us with a great authority. Help us to not abuse or take that authority for granted, but to serve humbly, to have ears to listen, to discern, and to be able to experience you through conversation and dialogue in all ways. We pray in your mighty name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Madam Clerk, would you please take roll?
Representative Allers, Anderson, Bartles, Bartling, Beal, Bordeaux, Bruner, Campbell, Carson, Chase, Clark, Consett, Dennard, DeSanto, Duval, Freimuller, Glanzer, Goodwin, Gosch, Greenfield, Hager, Haugart, Holly, Heineman, Holmes, Howard, Hunhoff, Jameson, Jensen, Johns, Johnson, Kaiser, Carr, Kettwig, Lake, Latterell, Lesmeister, Livermont, Lust, Marty, May, McCleary, McPherson, Mills, Otten, Ken Peterson, Sue Peterson, Pischke, Qualm, Rasmussen, Reed, Roden, Ring, Rounds, Rosem, Schaefer, Shanefish, Smith, Soli, Steinhauer, Stevens, Teason, Tulson, Turbeville, Willitson, Wismer, Woolman, York, Zickman, Speaker Mickelson.
Here.
Mr. Speaker, a quorum is present.
Very good. Thank you, Madam Clerk. Approval of the journal.
Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the Chief Clerk of the House has had under consideration the House Journal of the fifth day. All errors typographical or otherwise are duly marked in the temporary journal for correction, and we hereby move the adoption of the report. Respectfully submitted, G. Markles, Mickelson, Chair.
Second.
Discussion on the motion? Hearing none, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Introductions. Well, I'll start things off with the doctor of the day, if they're here. Sarah Castellanos. Well, we'll come back to the doctor of the day. Representative Hawley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Personal privilege.
Granted.
On behalf of myself and Representative Tim Reed from District 7, we have Brookings Day at the legislature today, and we have the city of Brookings up with the council members and Deputy Mayor Keith Corbett. We have South Coast State University and President Dunn is up. We have the Brookings County Commission came up. The Brookings School District's up. And we have Leadership Brookings up here. So several of these members are up here from Brookings, so be careful what you say today. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Hawley. Anyone else have an announcement? Representative Mills.
I got to learn how to turn my microphone on. Mr. Speaker, thank you. I want to introduce the Sioux Valley High School government class and their instructor, Mr. Jordan Fast, and pleased to have them in the audience today.
So please wave your hand so we know who you are. There they are. Welcome.
Go Cossacks.
Representative Greenfield.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We have some young people in blue jackets up above us today. They are members of the South Dakota FFA. They are district officers. They've come to visit us in Pierre, and their sponsor, their advisor, Noel Swanson, is in my district, and I just want to greet them. And also, I've been asked to announce, remember the breakfast tomorrow morning, 6:30, America Inn. If you just stand.
Please go ahead and stand. I know I saw Hovind on the back of some jackets and Howard. Where are you kids in the middle from? Very good. And then the rest of the state's right there. Okay. Thank you, Representative Greenfield. Further announcements. Is the doctor of the day in the gallery? Oh, there she is. Okay. Up here in this gallery, we have Dr. Sarah Castellanos from Huron. The doctor of the day program is sponsored by the State Medical Association, and she is a specialist in obstetrics, I don't have that one yet, in gynecology. She received her degree from Kansas City University of Medicine and Biosciences, the College of Osteopathic Medicine, and completed her OBGYN residency in Detroit. She is the owner and founder of the Women's Wellness Center in Huron and is chief of medical staff at Huron Regional Medical Center. Please welcome Dr. Castellanos. Any other announcements? I have one for the beer wholesalers. Are there any representatives that want to make an announcement on behalf of the beer wholesalers? I will announce that we're reminded that the South Dakota Beer Distributors Association is having a reception at Red Rosa between 5:30 and 8 p.m. tonight, January 18th, brought to us by Nancy Johnson and Representative Beal. Seeing no further announcements, we'll move on to our next order of business, reports of standing committees.
The Committee on Commerce and Energy respectfully reports that House Bill 1048 and 1049 do pass, and House Bill 1047 and 1050 do pass and be placed on the consent calendar. Tim Rounds, Chair.
Messages.
Mr. Speaker, I have the honor to transmit herewith Senate Bills 37 and 38, which have passed the Senate, and your favorable consideration is respectfully requested. Respectfully, Kay Johnson, Secretary.
8, motions. Representative Consett. I'm not one of those. Okay, number 8, motions and resolutions.
Representative Qualm and Peterson jointly moved that a select committee on discipline and expulsion be established to investigate the conduct of Representative Matthew Woolman.
Is there a second? Representative Roden seconds. Discussion on the motion. And just to be clear, so you all heard, Representatives Qualm and Peterson jointly move for a select committee on discipline and expulsion be established. Representative Qualm.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Representative Woolman admitted to me of consensual sexual contact with an intern in both 2015 and 16. What we're doing is establishing a committee to see if there are any violations of conduct unbecoming a legislature according to our rules.
Thank you, Representative Qualm. Are there any further remarks on the motion? Any further remarks on the motion? Seeing none, this is not a motion for final disposition, it's a voice vote. And I'll read the motion so that you're all clear on it. It's a motion to establish a select committee in accordance with our rules, House Rule H6-1, to establish a select committee for purposes of determining whether there was inappropriate conduct and what penalty, if any, should be imposed. All members in favor of said motion, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed?
No.
Motion carries. Members of the body, the rules require the speaker to appoint a 9-member committee, 5 from the majority party, 4 from the minority party. I will do that after consultation with the majority leader and the minority leader, which I will do after session today, and we'll appoint that committee tomorrow during session. Item number 11, first reading of Senate bills.
Senate Bill 37, an act to repeal and revise certain outdated provisions regarding liens. Senate Bill 38, an act to revise certain references to the Internal Revenue Code.
The Speaker assigned Senate Bills 37 and 38 to the House Committee on Tax. We don't have a consent calendar today, so we're going to go to the second reading of House bills. We're going to consider and debate and vote on House bills.
House Bill 1022, an act to revise and repeal certain provisions relating to education service agencies.
House Bill 1022 is up for consideration and final debate. Are there any comments? Representative Howard, do you have any comments on House Bill 1022?
Yes, House Bill 1022 is simply cleaning up unnecessary language in the statutes. We know all the organizations that we currently have doing these professional development jobs for the schools are co-ops. We don't have any of the other nonprofits or ESAs, so this is getting rid of language that we no longer need in statute. So I would ask for your yes vote on this, and I stand by for further questions.
Nice job, Representative Howard. Thank you. Any further comments on House Bill 1022? Seeing none, the question before the body is final disposition on House Bill 1022. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed, nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Roten votes aye. Representative DeSanto, Goodwin, Sue Peterson, and Smith. Goodwin and DeSanto are excused. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Madam Clerk, please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are 64 yeas, 2 nays, 4 excused.
House Bill 1022, having received a majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed.
House Bill 1032, an act to revise certain provisions relating to child support.
House Bill 1032, having received a second consideration, is up for consideration and final debate. Are there any remarks?
Speaker.
Representative Stevens.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Members of the House, I have put on your desks five different exhibits, you might call them, to have you look at as we discuss this bill. House Bill 1032 is the product of the 2016 South Dakota Commission on Child Support, and federal law requires that we review our guidelines every 4 years, and this committee does that. The committee is made up of two members of the legislature. In our particular situation, it was Representative Gosch as well as Senator Art Rush, a non-custodial parent, a custodial parent, a referee, a individual from the South Dakota Department of Social Services, and they rely upon an expert whose expertise is in child rearing costs. And what the purpose of this bill really is, this is to update the guidelines and the figures that have been used for the last basically 8 years. The last adjustment that were made to the guidelines was 7.5 years ago. This committee meets only once every 4 years, so this is their recommendation for this year. They will not be meeting again for another 4 years. And as we know that the buying power of the child support payments the past 7.5 years have diminished because there's not been any change. Salaries have gone up, but the child support payments have remained the same unless the party has asked for a modification. If you look on the material that I gave you, number A, you're going to see a list from the South Dakota Department of Labor and Regulation as to what the cost of living increases have been during those past, since the last adjustment has been made. Now, what this bill addresses is the cost of living increases, and that's the main part of the bill. And I want to emphasize that this bill is not about shared parenting, and it's not about changing the formula, and it's not about how the parents spend this. What this is dealing with is updating these charts, and really what it comes down to is about the kids. You know, in my law practice, I spend at least 50% of my time dealing with family law issues, whether it be a divorce, child support, custody, or divorce. And the reality of that, the reality of this issue is this, is that most people who go through a divorce are having a hard time making it before they file for divorce, and not surprisingly, it becomes even harder when the same income is trying to fund two households. And obviously, it has been brought to my attention, the custodial, non-custodial parent will have some of the same similar expenses. However, from my experience, the custodial parent will have more expenses than the non-custodial parent. And you know, any financial issue that the non-custodial parent has will also be faced by the custodial parent with the knowledge that their expenses will be more. Now, questions have been asked is what is included and what is not included in the formula. And if you look at page number B, you're going to see examples. This is what the law is, and it says what it does include. And I've highlighted some of the things that, you know, you're going to expect the W-2 wages and self-employment agent, but you can see it's a very inclusive list as they try to determine what a person's income includes, which also includes Social Security benefits, veterans benefits, disability benefits, unemployment insurance benefits, and also a category entitled benefits in lieu of compensation. So I think it's a very comprehensive list. And one of the things that I've been asked is, well, what happens, you know, if we have a particular situation? What happens if there needs to be, you know, modification? It doesn't really fit into these particular boxes. Well, if you look at number C, you'll see factors considered for deviation from schedule. And this allows a referee or a judge to take people's particular situations and make it fit their situation, their financial situations. And I just highlighted a couple of them. Number two is any financial condition of either party would make application of the schedule inequitable. So it gives people an opportunity to tailor make this to their particular situation. And so if they're able to prove any of these deviations, then the court or the referee is able to make those changes. Now the formula, I think you need to understand it a little bit.
Steinhauer yields.
Thank you. It's pretty simple as how you do this. You take both parties' salaries, you add them together to determine the gross amount on the schedule that you have before you. And then each parent's salary is figured into that to come up with a percentage. And then you take that percentage against the child support amount to know what each person is supposed to pay. If there's any difference in salary, an adjustment is made so that the children's standard of living remains the same, so they don't go having steak at one person's house and have chili and hot dogs in somebody else's. And there's a deviation to take care of that. Now, what I want to point out to you as you look at these is I've given you four different examples so you can take a look at it. The first example, D, is two families making the minimum wage. And everybody's presumed to be able to make the minimum wage. That figure is calculated in. And as you can see, the increase from what used to be and what is being proposed here is $7 a month, or a 2% increase. The next one is two families earning a gross income of $9,400 between the two of them. And you look at that, and that increase is $22 per month, or 4.3%. The next example is F, and that's where two families with gross income of over $10,200, and that's a $58, or a 5%. And the last one, which we've seen before, is G, and you can see what that increase is. Even though we've been talking mostly about increases on this and here, the examples that I gave you, you just need to understand that there have been modifications for the lower end of it. Our current law says that the minimum amount of child support is $216. What this law would do, if this law is passed and modifications made, would actually reduce that figure down to to $79 a month. So it's time to make the changes, and I would ask you for your support of House Bill 10, 32. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Stevens. Further remarks? House Bill 1032. Representative Pischke.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the House, I want to stand here today in opposition of House Bill 1032. This bill was drafted by the South Dakota Commission of Child Support, and just to bring a little bit of light on what the commission is made up of, the 7 members, 5 of which have ties to the agency or have ties to the South Dakota Bar Association, so just keep that in mind. There's 1 custodial parent, 1 non-custodial parent, and that commission is also headed by Judge Joni Cutler. Some of you may be familiar with Joni Cutler. She was actually a former legislator in the Capitol. And she's now a judge in Minnehaha County, Lincoln County. Because of her outspoken bias against shared parenting and non-custodial dads in the state of South Dakota, she's actually not allowed to rule on child custody hearings in Minnehaha County. So just keep that in mind. As many of you know, I passed out yesterday a child support obligation calculator. It's similar to what Mr. Stevens had. In that scenario, I laid out that there's 2 children in this scenario in a non-custodial situation. Both parents are making $16 an hour, which is very modest, and that comes to $33,280 a year gross. It comes to $2,373 gross per month for each parent. After taxes are taken out, that comes to $2,264 net for each parent. Okay? Add those together, you get a combined net income of $4,528. That goes into the graph in current statute and comes to a total support obligation of $1,310 right now. It would go to $1,404 if this bill gets passed. About a difference of $100 in this situation. So, in this situation, I calculated there would be a monthly medical insurance payment of $30 for the non-custodial parent on a single medical plan. Put in a number of $100, which I think is very, very modest for a family plan for the custodial parent who has the kids. Okay, with all that said, the adjusted child support obligation comes to $690 per month. Now, just to keep in mind, this doesn't take into account daycare. If these children are of age before school, daycare's on top of this. There's also no tax credit to the non-custodial parent. Even though you have a support obligation, you don't get any of the benefits of head of household or tax credit when April 15th rolls around. And also, there's no dependent care spending account. I believe federal statute says that you have up to $5,000 that you can spend tax-free on daycare. So, just want to give you all those numbers. Now, going back to the calculator, I had a monthly net income of $2,264. Now, you have to have a place to live. I mean, we all know that. I have a very modest amount of a 3-bedroom apartment of $750, vehicle payment $200, student loans $100, cell phone, utility bills. Add all those up, I come to bills of $1,260. It's a very reasonable number. After that, you have $314 left. Keep in mind, you still have to live. You haven't put any gas in your car. You haven't bought any food. You don't have any car insurance. You don't have any clothes. All that's going to get spent up. Basically, you're going to be left with $0 at the end of the month. So what ends up happening is that these non-custodials, they end up getting second jobs, third jobs, and now they don't have any time to spend with the kids. And that's really what this is all about, ladies and gentlemen. We need to make sure the kids are taken care of. And study after study has been shown that time with both parents is very important. So when you reduce one parent to just a visitor, you have detrimental impacts to society. So, the proponents of the bill are going to say that, you know, this hasn't been adjusted in 8 years. Yes, that is true. But as I just laid on this calculation, the numbers don't lie. I mean, it's still going to be very hard. So I don't see that's justified. If I do remember, the governor gave an address last week stating that revenues are down, eggs down. I mean, people are making less money. I mean, that's something to consider. And also, I did some stat digging last night. The average family income in South Dakota in 2008 was $66,165. Now, mind you, I gave you a number in the beginning of this. I gave you a
Palm Beach to it.
Thank you so much. I gave you a number in the beginning of this calculation of $66,560 combined gross income. This very median income in the statistics shows $66,165 in 2008. As of 2015, the number is $67,643. That's a 2% increase over the last 8 years. So things aren't as rosy as Mr. is a good representative from Yankton County may have alluded to. So, and also, I did some fact-checking on the comparison just from the current statute of what the net, let me get the term right, total support obligation would be for certain scenarios in the graph, right? So for $5,000 in current statute, that comes to a combined, that comes to a obligation of $1,354, and if this bill is passed, it will go to $1,447, a 7% increase. At $10,000, it's $1,868. It's going to go to $2,002, a 7.2% increase. At $15,000, now this is where it gets interesting. It's currently $2,334. It's going to $2,385. Only a 2.2% increase. And at $20,000 combined net income, it was $2,963. It's going to $3,015. A 1.8% increase. So what the commission did is the people that are struggling to make it had the highest increases in the graph, a 7% increase. But the people that didn't or have more expendable money, they only increased their amounts 2.2, 1.8%. I don't know, seems wrong to me. So other objections to my testimony are going to be that the total support obligation is only going up $100 in my situation, and that's only $50 for the non-custodial. Sure, $50. It's not a lot of money to some of us, but to tell you what, to a non-custodial parent who only has $314 left at the end of the month, and they still have to buy gas, clothes, food, $50 is a lot of money. I encourage you to vote no. Thank you.
Representative Pischke, I've been encouraging my children to spend a lot of time studying math. Looks like that work paid off for you. Thank you. We have any further remarks on House Bill 1032? Representative May.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Question for the sponsor.
Go ahead.
If the salaries go down, is there an adjustment made? So if somebody's
Representative Stevens, do you wish to answer the question?
I'd love to answer the question.
Go ahead.
We have a process that is already set up, so if an individual's income goes down, they can apply to have a modification of their child support.
Representative May, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. So can you elaborate a little bit on that process, how that works? And
is that a follow-up question? Go ahead.
Thank you.
Representative Stevens, you wish to answer the question?
Yeah, if the salary goes down, they can modify it. No, I'm sorry.
I tell you what, we'll just grant you a little latitude, not that you need it to be granted, but go ahead and ask him.
There is a petition that can be filed by either party when there's been a change of material, change of circumstances, whether either party's salary goes up or whether or not it goes down. They can then file through the Department of Social Services without even an attorney and file a petition and state what those changes of circumstances are, how that would change their child support, and then they'll have a hearing on it, and the court can determine whether it needs to go up or down. So it works for both parties, a custodial or a non-custodial.
So it goes, Mr. Speaker? So
Thanks
it goes
asking.
In front of a judge then?
Right now we have the system that's set up. Now, in the olden days, you'd have to file it with the court. Now you file a petition with the Department of Social Services Child Support Division, and you file that petition with everybody's tax returns. They then set up a hearing in front of an attorney an individual trained as an attorney who acts as a referee and who specializes in the child support guidelines and rules. The two parties come together. That referee gets all of that information from them. And then that person makes a decision of whether the child support goes up or down. Whenever they, after they make that decision then is sent to the circuit court, and the circuit court then, the individuals have 10 days to appeal the referee's decision. If they don't appeal it, then the judge will sign an order setting the new child support. If the individuals disagree with it and appeal it, then the judge reviews the decision of the referee. They can either change it or send it back to the referee for further instructions. So there's already an appeal process that's already set up. I think it costs $50 in order to go through that entire process.
Representative May.
Thank you,
what
Mr.
you getting
Speaker.
At? Oh.
Well, I guess what I'm concerned about is ag being the number one industry in the state of South Dakota. We've lost 70% of our market in the last 16 months. And so if this is only reviewed every 4 years, are they going to, somebody that's a producer and is in this situation, are they going to have to go back every year if they're losing part of the market and their income is basically zeroed out?
Well, I want to apologize for misunderstanding your question. What everybody needs to understand is the guidelines themselves, the actual numbers that you see out, those are only reviewed every 4 years. That committee only reviews those numbers. An individual can ask for a modification every year. So if you have the farming situation and they have a really good year, they can request for it to be modified up. If they have a really bad year, they can go in front of the referee and ask for it to be reduced. So the four-year thing only applies to those many pages of numbers. Those numbers stay the same for 4 years. So whatever we decide here today, those numbers stay the same for another 4 years. Those do not change. Individuals can apply to modify their child support obligations whenever their circumstances have changed. I'm sorry for missing.
Thank you, Representative Stevens. Thank you, Representative May. Anything further, Representative May? Okay. At this point, I'll take a pause in the debate and just say, for those of you who are new, we're early in session. This is our first calendar debate. So every member has the right to stand up and ask a question of another member. They run their questions through the chair, just like in a committee, so through the speaker. Recognize. Then the representative to whom the question's asked, I will ask them if they choose to answer the question. They do not have to. Okay? So that's typically how the process works. All right. Further comments on House Bill 1032? Seeing none. The question before the body is final passage of House Bill 1032. Members in favor shall vote aye. Those opposed will vote nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Quorum votes no. Consent votes aye. Representative Freimuller. Representative Freimuller.
Who is it? Oh, perfect time since we're still voting. But every representative that's present on the House floor does need to vote. Usually we'll leave the vote open about 30 seconds.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Madam Clerk, please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are 31 yeas, 35 nays, 4 excused.
House Bill 1032, having failed to receive the majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared failed. Since you're new here, there's 70 people. We need 36 on a simple majority vote, some of you.
House Bill 1025, an act to revise certain provisions regarding background checks for applicants, licensees, vendors, and employees of the South Dakota Lottery.
House Bill 1025, having had a second reading, is up for consideration and final debate. Are there any remarks? Representative Turbeville.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, members of the House. I'm here today to ask for your positive vote on House Bill 1025, which has to do with the South Dakota Video Lottery, which I will tell you that this past year, the lottery gave back to the state of South Dakota almost $118 million. Based on this, we must make sure that we keep the video lottery employees and those working throughout the state squeaky clean. Current law states that no one may be licensed by lottery involved in lottery activities if the person has been convicted of a felony in this or any other jurisdiction and be subject to a background investigation by the lottery. These laws cover lottery employees as well as applicants, licensees, and vendors. Applicants, licensees, and vendors are those people that own and operate the video lottery stores as you see throughout the state. Today, the background investigation for lottery employees, applicants, licensees, and vendors is limited to only a South Dakota records check through the Division of Criminal Investigation. The Federal Bureau of Investigation requires states to pass laws that clearly ask the FBI to perform a fingerprint check on the FBI system before the FBI will perform the fingerprint check. 1025 makes it clear that lottery employees must undergo a nationwide criminal background check and that their employment and continued employment is dependent upon successfully passing the criminal background check. The bill also makes it clear that lottery applicants, licensees, and vendors must also undergo a nationwide criminal background check. In summary, House Bill 1025 extends the background investigation for lottery employees as well as applicants, licensed, and vendors. Today, the background check is only by the South Dakota State System. The change made by 1025 is that the background check is by both the South Dakota State System and the FBI system. And then with that, Mr. Speaker and members of the House, I'll conclude my presentation. I want to thank you for your time and your attention, and I will certainly be available for any questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Turbeville. Further remarks, House Bill 1025. Further remarks, House Bill 1025. Seeing no further remarks, the question before the House is final passage of House Bill 1025. Members in favor will vote aye, those opposed will vote nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Madam Clerk, please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are 66 yeas, 4 excused.
House Bill 1025, having received the majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed.
House Bill 1033, an act to authorize criminal background checks for certain executive branch employees and state contractors and subcontractors.
House Bill 1033, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final debate. Are there any remarks?
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Beal.
Thank you. House Bill 1033 grants the legal authority for state and federal criminal background investigation of any executive branch employee, contractors, or subcontractors who have access to the confidential taxpayer information received from the IRS. Currently, an individual who has access to such information is not required to have a background information prior to gaining access to the information. In September 2016, the Internal Revenue Service updated its security requirements for the state entities that to receive confidential taxpayer information, and the new regulations require that any employee or contractor that has access to the federal to the confidential taxpayer information received from the IRS undergo state and federal background investigations prior to gaining access. Per the restrictions, the FBI requires that the state must pass a law similar to this. I please urge for your support in this measure. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Beal. Further remarks, House Bill 1033. Seeing none, the question before the body is final passage of House Bill 1033. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed will vote nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Representative Allers and Johns. Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Madam Clerk, please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are 65 yeas, 1 nay, 4 excused.
House Bill 1033, having received the majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed.
House Bill 1028, an act to revise certain provisions regarding the interception of certain communications.
House Bill 1028, having received its second reading, is up for consideration and final debate. Are there any remarks? Representative Reed.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, members of the House, this is an agency bill, HB 1028, and it is an act to revise certain provisions regarding the interception of certain communications. This is an update to an existing chapter that was originally passed in 1969, and last time it was changed was 1988. This is an outdated statute that does not allow for data, voice, and image acquisition. If the criminal utilizes communication devices other than wired or landline communication devices, and this would be cellular or wireless communication, you know, and we all know that's the choice of communications today. The update does not change the requirements how you obtain authorization for the tap of the mobile phone. It must be approved via application to the court to conduct the stated activity contained in the statute. It's very important to note that all the information obtained must be given to the courts for review and is subject to the rules of discovery if an arrest or an indictment does occur. And just like it is today, there's really nothing changes there. It really just has to do with the ability to tap your mobile device. We all know that meth arrests have really increased in South Dakota. They doubled from 2012 to 2013 and continue to go up. And this is a way that can help our law enforcement catch the criminals that are distributing meth. This has been supported by the DCI, the Sheriff's Association, our Attorney General, the Police Chiefs Association, and the South Dakota State's Attorney. I ask your support of this bill in order to update the current statute.
Thank you. Nice work, Representative Reed. Further remarks? House Bill 1028. Further remarks on House Bill 1028? Seeing none, the question before the body is final passage of House Bill 1028. Those in favor will vote aye. Those opposed will vote nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Madam Clerk, would you please display the vote?
Mr. Speaker, there are 65 yeas, one nay, four excused.
House Bill 1028, having received the majority vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed approved.
House Bill 1041, an act to place certain substances on the controlled substance schedules and to declare an emergency.
House Bill 1041, having had its second reading, is up for consideration and final debate. Are there any remarks? Representative McPherson.
Mr. Speaker, there's an amendment to the original bill to clean up language and make it consistent in all sections.
Has it been distributed?
Yes.
Do you wish to move it at this time?
Yes.
Do you wish to discuss the amendment and the bill?
Discuss the amendment and the bill. The bill is simply the mirror image of the Drug Enforcement Agency's controlled substance list and the scheduling of those drugs. They update it every year so that we have legal and prosecutable wording in the Schedule 1, 2, and 3 of all the drugs. And so this is just the mirror of the DEA.
So for purposes of clarification, the motion before you is an amendment. And I'm confirming with Representative McPherson, it's 1041-CA.
Yes.
Okay. Representative Steinauer.
I just want to point out that this amendment is a friendly amendment.
Thank you. Further remarks on the amendment or the bill? Seeing none, the question before the body is approval of Amendment 1041-CA. All those in favor shall signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. The amendment's approved. We are now on 1041-CA is amended. Is there further discussion? Representative Rounds.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And I think we've talked about this a little bit, ladies and gentlemen. This bill has an emergency clause on it, and I'm going to ask you to support this because, you know, frankly, these synthetic drugs are manufactured long before we see it here in the legislature, and they're probably on the streets today. This needs to be implemented as soon as possible, so our law enforcement can deal with it. Our Attorney General's office, DCI, can deal with these synthetic drugs that are out there. And they seem to develop these faster than we can keep up with them. So I'm asking you to support the bill and support the emergency clause on the bill. Thank you.
Appreciate those remarks. Representative Rounds, further comments? Representative Gash.
My only concern on this bill right now, and we mentioned it earlier, was the cross-reference of the chemicals that are involved in the bill. They're using a lot of big words. We don't know what they are. And to my knowledge, they have not yet been cross-referenced with agricultural chemicals. And it's my fear that maybe some of these chemicals would limit the agricultural industry to treat crops and take care of pest control. So that's why I'll be voting no on this amendment or measure.
Thank you, Representative Gash. Further remarks on 1041 as amended? Representative Wismer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. To the sponsor of the bill.
Go ahead.
I'm wondering if you could respond to the concern of the previous speaker.
Representative McPherson or any other member of the chamber, do you wish to answer that question? Representative Heineman, Representative Wismer, is it okay if Representative Heineman answer that question? Go ahead, Representative Heineman.
Yes, Mr. Speaker, thank you. The chemicals you are talking about are most likely addressed in a different statute. I'm not an attorney, I haven't looked at the statute over there, but they've already been, they're addressed in a different statute. So this is clearly within the purview of the FDA-approved drugs. Ones that are not approved, they have to put on a schedule. So even though they're synthetics, they're derivatives of drugs that we currently do not allow, in particular for Schedule I drugs, which are considered illegal and of no medical use. So the chemicals you're talking about are really dealt with in a different statute. So this is a necessary part. I've been here 5 years, and every year we have an updated list. And every year we have the newer members of the legislature questioning if we're trying to get through something that isn't quite right. And I can assure you, 2 years ago we went through a lengthy discussion of why we do this. Typically it's a process that we just go through, and it actually be on consent calendar, except it's an emergency clause, so we have to debate it on the floor. So
appreciate that answer, Representative Heineman. Further remarks? Representative Hunhoff.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In regards to the drugs that are put on there, fentanyl is something typically that's used for pain management. In fact, probably someone that's got severe pain, cancer patients, whatever, their fentanyl patches. Because they're on this schedule, they're controlled drugs, which means they can't have access to the public. And so if they're going to be given, they'd have to be through a physician that would prescribe those. That's what's controlled. The other on there is also a pain management drug. So really, these are narcotics that anesthesia, anesthetists might use in procedures where a patient has to not be awake for that. But as far as your question to that, these are directly, they're currently could be used, and they are, as I said, the fentanyl. You know people that have fentanyl patches. And so it's just to, it's a different category, as the good representative from Flandreau said, they've made some modifications to keep them out of public hands and keep them in a controlled environment. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Representative Hunhoff. Further remarks? Representative Haugard.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just as a clarification on that, too, I think the main drug that came onto this list this year was fentanyl and fentanyl derivatives, and that is a drug that's being produced in mass quantities down in Mexico because of the drug trade trying to keep it cheap and cutting that with heroin. So that's part of the reason it has to be added, is to have those specifics in there so prosecutions can go forward. As far as overlapping with farm chemicals, they're not going to overlap with farm chemicals. There might be some issues in regard to drugs that veterinarians would use, but they too were subject to all the DEA requirements, so they have to go through the same process to get those drugs and use them for animals as well. So it's not an issue that's going to affect farming. It's just simply an issue to make sure prosecutions can go forward so someone doesn't have an effective defense as to a technical description of a drug.
Thank you, Representative Haugard. Are there further remarks on 1041 as amended? Does any representative wish to speak for a first time before Representative Gosch speaks for a second time? Representative Gosch, go ahead.
And this is just for clarity. Now, am I under the understanding from the good representative from Flandreau that this only applies towards the medical field? It does not ban any of these from an agricultural standpoint? Okay, all right. Thank you.
I would ask that you address that question, Representative Heineman. Representative Heineman, do you wish to answer that question?
Yes, Mr. Speaker.
For the record,
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, very good. Representative Gosch. Further remarks on 1041 as amended. As was mentioned by one of the speakers, this bill has an emergency clause, and under our state's constitution, An emergency clause requires a two-thirds vote to the members-elect, which is 47. All those members in favor of final passage of House Bill 1041 as amended will vote aye. All those opposed will vote nay. The clerk will unlock the voting machine and the members will proceed to vote.
Mr. Speaker, all members present have voted.
Madam Clerk, please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there are 65 yeas, one nay, four excused.
House Bill 1041 as amended, having received the two-thirds vote of the members-elect, is hereby declared passed. Are there any questions on the title? Seeing none, the title is deemed approved. Announcements. Representative Rasmussen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Transportation will meet tomorrow at 10 a.m. We will have an overview from the Department of Transportation.
Representative Ott.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. House Ag, tomorrow morning, 7:45. We have one bill, and we'll be hearing from the Department of Environment and Natural Resources.
Representative York. Thank you. Representative Steinhauer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Health the Committee on Health and Human Services, I'll get it out. We'll meet. Thank you, Representative from Minnehaha County, for that thumbs up. We're going to meet tomorrow morning at 7:45. We've got five bills.
Very good. Representative Teason.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Retirement Laws Committee will meet in 10 minutes in room 413 and we'll start with an overview of the retirement system, if you're interested, followed by bill hearings.
Complicated topic, important topic, considering some matters of consequence. For those of you who are so inclined, would encourage you to attend. 413. Further announcements. Representative Ollers.
Appropriations will meet tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. We'll be hearing from Agriculture, Public Safety, Revenue, and the Department of Labor and Regulation.
Thank you, sir. Further announcements?
Mr. Speaker.
Representative Beal.
Let's get out of here.
We have a motion to adjourn. Is there a second? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, nay. We're adjourned.